Now, it's an honor to speak about science and faith here at Park Street, even if the introduction exposes science anxieties. And after that introduction, I will try and teach you a little science. You've just made it irresistible. I occasionally talk about science and faith, maybe a couple of times a year. I much prefer talking about science. The most unusual case of talking about science and faith happened a few years ago when I went to Peking University. And I gave a talk which probably could have gotten me arrested if I had been a citizen. Okay, it was a very straightforward exposition of how a scientist could be a person of faith. And now in science, in China, they really revere scientists. I mean, the United States could learn something about that, you know. And in China, they have a lot of people, what, 1.4 billion people. And what I was told was they wanted to hear from Christians, okay, about how they could be how they could be scientists to try and learn from the learn about the morality. They didn't want the religion, they just wanted the morality as a way of keeping 1.4 billion people in check, okay? They're also looking to Marxists at the same time. It's a discredited economic and social system, but you know, there's a system of morality that goes with it. Now, unlike at Peking University or most other places where I've talked about science and faith, I'm told that most of you will be Christians. So I'm going to just find out, because I like, how many of you would identify as Christians? Okay, so that's pretty well. So I'll use a few words that I wouldn't normally use in a talk like this. I'll use the word faith, for example. I wouldn't use the word faith if I was talking at Cambridge University, okay? How many of you are scientists? Well, that's not so bad. How many are science students aspiring to be scientists? Okay, same difference, okay, because if you do graduate work, you know that the students are the ones who do all the work anyway. The professors just bluff better, so. Okay, now, as I speak to you today, you should realize that it's a bit unusual for a physicist like me to be giving a lecture like this. It's not that physicists don't give many lectures. In addition to my regular Harvard lectures, I've given as many 50 outside lectures in a year. But most were about science at professional conferences, university colloquia, popular science venues, and even in high school. And I love to talk about our experiments. I'll do a little bit today. How we observe the dance of a single particle that we suspend in empty space. How our most precise measurement of the properties of an elementary particle agree with the most precise prediction from our modern theories. How we produce and capture atoms made completely out of antimatter. And how we use the immense electric field within a polar molecule to look for a tiny, tiny distortion of the charge of the electron. This is great stuff, and even though I'm more than sick of airplanes and hotels, I still get a huge kick out of telling an interested audience about our scientific exploits. A lecture on science and faith is quite different. Most scientists, active scientists at least, some retired scientists do, but most active scientists do not give such lectures. And I'll use a graph to demonstrate what giving lectures on science and faith mean for a scientific career. Now, here's the progress of a scientific career, and in science we use graphs, so suck it up and there's going to be a graph, okay? On the vertical scale is career success measured in some units, and then there's time on the horizontal axis. So you're born, okay? That's one data point, okay? Now that can be kind of controversial how that happens, but I won't get into that, okay? And then you write your first scientific paper. The slope is up, that's important, okay? So you write more papers, because it's kind of fun. Alistair writes books, but in my field we write papers, okay? And then you wake up someday and time has gone by and you're well known for a successful research program. Well, this is pretty good. Well, then you write your first review paper. Now you're not talking about your work anymore. You're talking about what others did. And then you become department chair. Now the slope is going down, okay? And then they give you prizes. They put you in the National Academy. But the lowest level is to lecture about religion. Okay? So, now, the flip side of that, okay, the flip side of that is what the scripture says, okay? There's some truth to that description, I must say, but there's a higher view, and if you're a Christian, I think you sort of have to take it, even if you don't want to. Okay, and Peter, the most impulsive of Jesus' disciples, said, "Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give hope, to give reason for the hope you have in you." Okay, now that's a pretty direct statement. It makes sense. Okay, and he prefaces that by saying, "In your hearts, revere Christ as Lord." So that's the context. Okay, it's not just giving account. And in the end, which is a really interesting statement for Peter, he said, "Do this with gentleness and respect." Now, when I think about Peter, it's not gentleness that is the first adjective that comes to mind. But, you know, he learned. He was maybe a little older when he wrote this. And so, okay. Now, as an active scientist, I will try to give an account today of the hope that is in me, how my faith enables and energizes my science. This is apologetics, I guess, though I'm not very fond of the A word. Okay, I don't think I've ever described it for in my life to describe what I do when I speak about science and faith. The A word sounds too much like apology. And what I do today is not an apology for my faith, it's my story. Now here's some disclaimers, and I have to say this. No one should believe me or discard what I say today because I am a wonderful, successful, or because I'm a terrible person. I am an intense and driven person. I'm aware of an impressive list of personality defects, and those around me can identify more. Ask my wife. For scientists, this is normally not a big problem. I willingly listen to scientists who I know are not very wonderful people, and I test their science, you know, as I listen on its merits. And my request is that you test what I say about science and faith. Who knows, what I say may be useful or even right, despite the fact that it comes from someone with my defects. When folks, even some Christians, say, "Science says," especially in some sermons, I must say, I often do not recognize what they mean by science. And if we're going to have a bit of a discussion on science and faith, we should maybe agree on what science is. Now, if I were a historian, I would be tempted to do a careful history of how our idea of science and doing science developed over the centuries. If I were a philosopher, I might try to make a careful, abstract definition of science. But physicists like me are people who realize that we only have enough brain cells to contemplate a few particles. Okay? And believe it or not, one project that my students and I have spent many years on is the study of a single elementary particle, an electron. So instead of a general definition of science, I will tell you about the common sense game that we play to learn about the electron. A game has rules and it has players. That's why I don't mean it to trivialize what happens in science. And then I will label from the example what we do and the approach as science, or at least one example of doing science, because I think it may be easier to understand that way. Now, the electron is really common. All of the matter we see in our universe is made out of lightweight electrons, along with protons and neutrons that are 2,000 times heavier. Who would have thought that with only three different kinds of particles, we can make all that we can see in the universe? That's remarkable if you take the time to think about it. Alistair McGrath and Richard Dawkins are made of the same three particles. Imagine that. All right? All right? Now, in my body, there are nearly 10 to the 29th electrons. Now, some of you who haven't done science for too many years, okay, 10 to the 29th means 10, and then I add 29 zeros, okay? That's a lot of electrons. I was trying to figure out how I can make it clear how many that is. So I said, well, if I lined up all of the electrons in my body, and I put them all 1 inch apart, okay, and I started going around the Earth, okay, how many times could I go around? Well, the answer was 10 to the 19th. Now, 10 to the 19th is also too big, so I need to have some way to explain to you what 10 to the 19th is, because I can't imagine that either. But you get the point. It's a lot of electrons, right? Now, the electron is really an amazing particle. It's so small that the most precise way to measure its size and to see if there are some hard bits hiding inside is to shoot other particles at it as fast as you can and see if any pieces come out. Okay, now this would be a terrible way to do biology, right? I mean, you take one chicken and another chicken. No, it's not. Okay. But with particles, it works. Okay? Now, if there are hard bits inside of the electron, then some of the particles that are crashing into it should bounce back, right? And if there aren't any hard bits, they won't. Well, nothing bounces back that's consistent with hard bits. And so in physics, we've been unable to detect any size at all to the electron. Now, that's weird, right? I mean, we know everything has size. You can't really have a point particle. Okay, and yet, as far as we know, and most physicists believe this, an electron is a point particle with nothing in size. Okay, but there's more to the story. The particle with no size, it has mass, and it has charge. Now, where you stuck that stuff is not so clear, okay, but it has charge and it has mass. It's undeniable, right? What gives size to our bodies, in fact, is the electron going around the proton in orbits. That's what gives us the size in our body. So and it gives us part of our mass. Now, when many of us were children, we played with tops. Remember tops? I don't see younger people playing with them anymore. But you spin a top, and then it stays upright. The amazing electron acts as if it's spinning, even though there's nothing rotating, as far as we can tell. So who ordered that, right? Okay. In addition to charge and mass, the electron that has no size, okay, it acts like a magnet. Okay, well, jeepers, this is pretty intricate, okay? Now, some of my graduate students and I spent about 20 years measuring the size of this magnet. Why? We could have gotten a real job and made lots of money, okay? All right, well, for some decades, physicists have been developing an intricate mathematical description of elementary particles, like the electron. And this description we now call by a really unimaginative name. We call it the Standard Model. Ugh. Okay, and you've heard about the discovery of the Higgs particle lately. There was a big flap. Okay, that was sort of the capstone of the Standard Model. It was the missing piece. And there was a prediction, and people looked, thousands and thousands of physicists looked, and boy, they found it. Okay, that's the Standard Model. Now, in this serious but fun game we call science, the goal is to make a description, a mathematical description for this type of physics. And we want to compare the properties of the particles that we can predict to the properties of the particles we can measure. After scores of person years of concentrated effort, many years of supercomputer time, the Standard Model prediction produced a number. Okay, and I have the number here. Okay, this is the top value. Now, this top value, and I'll put a cursor by it if, I guess I should check to see if it's actually showing up there. Okay, that's a prediction. It's the size of the magnet in some units. We won't talk about what the units are right now. It's beyond the point, okay? Take all the time. Now, this is an incredibly precise prediction to about parts in 10 to the 12. Okay, now it's incredible that we can predict something that accurately in reality, right? If I say I want to measure something in inches, I can get it to the nearest inch or the nearest tenth of an inch or a hundredth of an inch. But a part in 10 to the 12, a trillionth, you know, that's getting harder. So there's this very precise prediction. But is the prediction right? And here's where I say God decides we measure. Okay? So my students and I decided to test the prediction. And for if we measure a magnet size that differs from the prediction, then we would prove that the mathematical description was wrong. Now it's important to realize we could never prove that the theoretical description was right. Okay, this is an important point about science. Because even if we measured the magnet size that was predicted, we could not prove that some other prediction, you know, would be violated later, or we could not prove that if we measured it in days to come, that there wouldn't be a different value, that somehow it changed. Okay, so in science, you only can falsify things. You can't absolutely prove they're correct. Okay? And so what would we find when we looked? We did not know. God decides the size of the magnet we measure. So my students and I built a very intricate apparatus in my basement lab at Harvard. And within it, we were able to suspend a single electron all by itself in a nearly perfect vacuum. Once we kept one single electron by itself for more than 10 months. Okay, and while we were measuring it, we got kind of fond of it, and I was I was actually a little unhappy with the colleague who lost it. He called me on the telephone, and my wife was witnessing this, and I was very nice and I was very polite on the phone, and I'm afraid, this is a confession, you know, I put down the phone and I think I said something which wasn't quite as charitable as what I had said on the phone. So. But our electrical signals with our electron make the electron dance, a quantum dance, okay, between the lowest quantum states of its motion. And because the dance takes place in an incredibly strong magnetic field from a superconducting magnet, the dance told us the size of the magnet in the electron. And we were able to measure the size of the electron's magnetic moment even more precisely than it's been predicted so far, to an unusually high precision of 3 parts in 10 to the 13. Okay? There aren't many measurements made with that sort of thing, with that sort of precision. This is the most precisely measured property of an elementary particle. It's the most precise prediction of the standard model, and it's the most precise comparison of any theory and experiment. One can't help but be impressed that mathematics describes physical reality that well. Why should that be? Now, in January, another measurement we did was reported on the cover of the journal Science. And in response to predictions that the charge of the electron should be a little bit squished, okay, inside no size, how you squish things, I don't know, but okay, I'll just say it anyway, okay? And so there was this prediction, and at a precision 12 times better than had previously been measured, we found that the electron was still round, okay? But the prediction, the predictors had a little wiggle room. There were free parameters in their theory. So we have to measure it a little more precisely, and either we'll discover the squishiness of the electron, or these models will be discredited. Sometimes the predictions are right. Sometimes the predictions are wrong. God decides, we measure. Now, what do these examples illustrate about science? Science is a game with rules that scientists agree upon. We make a description of some part of reality that we think we understand. We make new predictions based upon this prescription. Then we measure to see if the prediction is right or it's wrong. We never completely prove that the prediction or the description is right. But if we fail to measure results that disagree, then we as a community slowly reach a consensus that our description is probably right. Now here I want to just take make a bit of a contrast to something that Alistair said yesterday, for those of you who were here. He accurately described science as a journey. Okay? And science is a journey in the sense that we're always willing to revise our descriptions if we can get a better description. So he's absolutely right by that. That's not to say it's a random walk. Okay? There are some things that we know much better than others. Okay? I would be incredibly surprised if Newton's law of gravity ever gets modified. There might be a modification in the 10th or 12th significant figure, okay? But, you know, it's established. So it's not like it's just a wandering all around, okay? Because in the American context, I think sometimes people just write off science they don't understand and just say, well, they're going to change their mind anyway. There's a lot of things that I think are pretty well established. Now, the sociology of adopting a new description or a paradigm is very interesting, but we don't really have time to talk about it. One point to make about science is even if almost everybody agrees in science, there are always some dissenters, okay? If you're a scientist, you're a professional skeptic, right? Okay, my role with my students is I'm trying to pick holes in what they're doing all the time. It's not a personal thing. We're just trying to make sure we got it right, okay? For example, even if 98% of climate scientists agree that the Earth is warming, you will always find 2% who disagree, okay? So in the press, you always have to quote one person on one side and one person on the other side. So in science, there's always somebody on the other side because somebody's always entertaining another theory of how it may work. Okay, it doesn't mean that something's wrong. Okay, that's science. I want to give you, I'm first talking about science. Now I'm going to talk about faith. Okay, and this is not a word I usually put in talks, but you're mostly Christian. So God decides we measure, if you take it very seriously, not just as a quip, it's actually a faith statement. Okay, and faith, you probably know the Bible's definition since it's so direct from Hebrews 11. Faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Now, notice that God is not mentioned in this definition of faith. Okay? It doesn't say it's not faith in God. Faith, it can be faith in anything. Okay? Faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Now, faith for me, my faith, means that I make assumptions that I accept without proof. Okay? I have faith in the God described in the Bible. I have confidence in this God from whom I derive hope and meaning even if I do not see him. You know, I kind of wish there were neon signs that said, I exist, right? Okay, that God would put up from time to time. It would make life easier. But for whatever reason, he hasn't decided to do that. And many scientists, most of my science, my students and colleagues, have faith that is not in God, but is instead faith in nature or humanity or in themselves, some God substitute. Okay, and without proof, they, like me, they assert that serving these alternatives to God is what gives the meaning and hope to their life and their science. There seems to be a deep human need to worship a God, if it be the God that many of us know or some sort of substitute. I think this is the heart of apologetics to me. Okay? By faith, you can either assume that there's an innate intellectual weakness in people and they fill it with God. Okay? Or you can believe by faith that this is the manifestation, this longing for God is the manifestation of being in God's image. But you decide by faith. You don't decide by proof. Okay? You start doing your logic after you make your assumptions. Now, this seems to me a really critical point that we Christians should stress as we give account of the hope that is in us, as we do apologetics, if we must use the A word. Everyone has faith, be we Christian or non-Christian. We should insist on it. Gently and kindly, okay, but we should insist on it. A lost element of Christian apologetics, in my view, is in making sure that the universality of faith, everybody has faith, that and also we've lost the ability to identify what are the God substitutes. When a scientist says to us, you have faith and you believe stuff, I can do without it, okay, that's not a statement that we can just let pass, really. And I'm not recommending an argument, I'm just saying that there's an assumption there. And at some point, when the occasion presents itself, that's as, I can do without it is as much a faith statement, okay, as my statement that I believe in God. Now, I believe that Alistair has already written two books that challenge Richard Dawkins' attempt to discredit the Christian faith. This may already be more books than the quality of Dawkins' arguments deserve, in my view, okay? But if he does write a third, I recommend a title for him. I think it should be titled The Faith of Richard Dawkins, okay? And ideally, Richard in the foreword will write the foreword, and he'll agree that Alistair has correctly identified his faith, okay? Because Richard Dawkins has a deep faith that our God is not God, okay? Now, the difference then between Christian and non-Christian is not that one has faith and one does not, as is often said. Both have faith, either in a God or some substitute. What is different is in who or what one places one's faith. Okay, I've talked about science, I've talked about faith, and since my faith is in God, I'm going to talk about God. Now, coming to Park Street Church to talk about God, I talk about bringing coals to Newcastle, okay? But I'm going to do it anyway, and I'm not going to say anything that's very different in some ways, but I may reach some surprising conclusions. So watch me like a hawk. Be the skeptical, okay? Now, referring to God is a bit frightening to me. Why? A God worth having, okay? Certainly the God I read of in the Bible, and a God capable of being responsible for the remarkably intricate and diverse universe that we study, such a God must be much greater, more complicated, and more powerful than we can ever imagine or express in the language of human experience. Now, if some of you don't believe in a God, that's okay for today, okay? But suspend your belief for a moment and imagine with me such a God. A God who is intelligent and powerful beyond human comprehension, the master of the universe, listening to what I publicly claim to know about God. Okay, think about that. The thought is frightening, right? Splat, you know. Now, I imagine that God has long since grown tired, perhaps even a bit numb, of overtly religious types who write books, pound pulpits, or expound to teleprompters, authoritatively proclaiming or pretending to capture the essence of God by enumerating human-like characteristics. Can't be done. I further imagine that God is just as tired and numb from folks who claim to speak with scientific authority about their own God delusion, a gutted version of God so limited they think they can disprove it with probability arguments. I mean, give me a break. Who wants a God like that? Now, for preachers and theologians to make such arguments and to be arrogantly certain is one thing. Not good, but it is one thing. Scientists, especially physicists, should know better. After being awed by the unbelievable vastness and always surprising intricacies of the physical world, we physicists should be more humble and more respectful of the limitations of our scientific craft and knowledge, whether our religious assumptions be those of a Christian or an atheist. Now, I am not very inventive in my view of God. My God is the God of Job, the epic tale of suffering and triumph that is part of the Bible. I highly recommend this tale to you folks who haven't read it recently. I claim that the story is more about God and less about heroic Job than is commonly supposed. I also strongly recommend it to you scientific types. You will not find more appreciation of the wonderful way that our universe is put together anywhere. Out of a storm, God thunders. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. You see, what had happened is Job, in his pain, had expressed some doubts about God's justice. Okay, and this provokes a very strong response from the Master of heaven and earth, one we shouldn't forget. And the fierce response shows how proud and involved God is with his universe, his earth, and his creatures. So reading again, out of the storm, God thunders, where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched out a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? Who shut up the sea behind the doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come and no further, this is where your proud waves halt. Page after page of passionate prose pours from the proud maker of heaven and earth, leaving no doubt of God's fierce pride in a creation that clearly gets his close attention. Job gets the message. One does not doubt or question the master of the universe. Humbled, he offers God his apology and his repentant silence. Now, faced daily by a wonderful reality filled with layers within layers of unbelievably intricate structure, I find it easy to ghostwrite extra verses for God's use when he must next confront my doubt. Where were you when I crafted the antiprotons you play with, when I bound the... I'm not Job, but I'm doing my best, okay? When I bound the quarks within, okay? And ordered them never to virtue out alone. Before the Big Bang, who presided? Who seeded the explosion that defies the imagination? And who steered the way to a world friendly to life from this unlikely beginning? The great master of the universe still has innumerable reasons to be proud of the intricacy in the universe. Much, even most, of what we do not yet understand. If the epic tale of Job were to be written today, many of the words and images would be different. But the point, I think, would be exactly the same. Now I want to say a few words about the Bible. My understanding about God clearly does not come from science. I know of no descriptions of God that I can make, which lead to predictions that my students and I can test with repeated and verifiable measurements, with the methods of science. My science, thus, does not enable me to make scientific statements about God. Based upon the science game that I play, as a scientist, I cannot even say that God exists. As a scientist, I also cannot conclude, based on my science, that God does not exist. I instead learn about God from the Bible, and I find John Calvin's analogy to be extremely useful. The Bible, he says, is the eyeglasses that God provides to us to make it possible to see that God is behind the science. Well, he said the earth and other things, but I'm saying science. Through these Bible glasses, through these corrective lenses, I came to appreciate the wonderful God who breathes and holds together all of the universe. This holds together science. He's the incredibly clever, interested, and powerful master of the universe. Now, I take the Bible to be literally true. Any part of the Bible that intends to be history, I think, should be read as history. Any part that is intended to be hymns of worship should be read as hymns of worship. Any part that intends to be poetry should be read as poetry. Any part that is a story intended to convey meaning and purpose should be read as such, and so on. Now, to add to my view of God, a view I find gives meaning to my science and empowers my science, I quote two other parts from the Bible. First, when Moses asked God about what name he should use to describe God, the answer he got was really unusual. God said his name was, I am who I am. Like, take that, Moses. I am who I am. Okay? He could have given other answers. God did not say he was the greatest ruler or pharaoh of all time, or the most powerful. The descriptive name he chose, and descriptions were important in names back then, there was no extrapolation or exaggeration of human characteristics. He was different. He was God, the master of the universe. The language of human experience was incapable of a good description. God was who he was, a God worth having, a God so much beyond human description that he could never be represented as a superhuman. The second passage that reveals a view of God that gives context and meaning to my science is from the first chapter of the Bible. I will paraphrase it, but I will read this paraphrase for the purpose that this meaning story was intended to serve, in my view, to demonstrate who was in control and what he was trying to accomplish. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. From a dark and formless mass, God made light. He separated the sky, land, and water. He filled the sea with fish and put animals and peoples on the land. And he looked over all that he had made and said, that's good. The sky was good, the land was good, the water was good, the plants were good, the sun, moon, and stars were good, the fish were good, the animals and people were good. God was clearly proud as he looked over all his creation and pronounced it all very good. For years, some Christians, particularly in the United States, not so much in other countries, have quarreled about how God created the world and universe. Did God use 6 days or was it longer? How did he manage to have lights and plants growing on earth before he made the sun, the source of all of our life and energy? It is amazing to me how certain some of us can be about the amazing, about the distant past, about things that happened long ago and in our absence. And I think the quarrelers missed the whole point of the creation story, in my view. The point is that God breathed the creation. God made his creation for his enjoyment. Everything that came into being did so because he wished it, and everything that remains does so because he wishes it. The notion that God breathes the universe leads to the metaphor that I find so useful as a scientist who's a person of faith. I visualize God as holding the world, representing the universe, of course, as holding the world in his hands. Except for these hands faithfully, actively, and continuously holding the world together, the universe together, it would simply come apart and cease to be. The presence of evil makes it difficult for any of us to see God's beautiful creation, to see the hands behind the reality. We need the Bible glasses to make this image. Now, whether we are Christians or not, we all perceive some of the ways that God holds things together. One way that God holds things together we call gravity. Atoms, rocks, planets, and stars all attract each other. God's gravity makes the sun attract the earth, so the earth orbits the sun. We are grateful because we always stay approximately the same distance from our source of heat and light. We never need freeze, we never need fry. God's gravity also attracts us to the earth. We don't think about it much, but how different life would be if I feared that every step I took could launch me into orbit outside the atmosphere I need to breathe and thrive. Some of the ways that God holds our reality together, those that God holds most tightly, I think, we call laws, or laws of physics, or laws of nature. Newton's laws and Coulomb's laws are familiar to every physics student. God's gravity we typically call the law of gravity. And whether or not I'm a Christian doesn't change the result. All are pulled to earth by God's gravity. And if I doubt it, I can do an experiment. I go to a third-story window and I step out, and then I find that gravity, yes, is still doing its thing and pulling me to earth. Okay? Now, long ago, I wondered if Christians would do physics differently than others would. And I spent a lot of time talking about that, reading about it. Over my years in physics, however, I have found that my non-Christian friends and I generally have no trouble agreeing about the methods and outcomes of good physics. I now understand this to be because God holds the reality together so tightly that none of us are able to mess it up much, however wacky and mistaken is our view of the world. I am glad for this state of affairs. It seems to me that similar agreement between Christians and non-Christians is not so easy for other parts of the creation that God holds together less tightly. Now I want to talk about some implications of this view. The view of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is exhilarating, energizing, and enabling for me as a scientist. It is the view of God, the great I am, that I learn when I view the universe through the Bible glasses that he kindly provided. This view of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe has many implications. I'll mention a few here and explore more this afternoon in the seminar in this room. One, taking care of the planet that God has entrusted to us. If you keep this image in mind, it's a lot harder to throw a beer can out the window or dump oil next to a stream. God clearly cares about the matter Earth that he has placed in our care. We small players in God's big universe have been temporarily entrusted with taking care of planet Earth. It is not our planet to exploit for our short-term profits. Of course, we should not leave our planet in worse shape than we inherited it. Christians, in my view, should be the staunchest defenders of the environment that's been placed in our care. We Christians should be changing our incandescent light bulbs to LEDs and insulating our houses. We should be driving bicycles and electric cars. The second implication, why should we do science? Well, the answer is simple. We do science, even the pure science with no evident applications like I do, to make God happy. I mean that seriously. We do science to make God happy. When he's happy, he sends rain on the rest of you, so it's good for everybody, okay? The whole culture reaps the reward of pure science, to be sure, as transistors, lasers, medical imaging devices, and so, you know, invented, discovered by pure scientists like me, have revolutionized our culture and our capabilities. My work, for example, has led up to a patent for an improved magnetic resonance imaging device. But that's not really why we do pure science. We do it as Christians to make God happy, and I find that invigorating, and I find it, you know, it enhances my science. Job's God clearly takes great pride in his masterpiece. I think he gets a huge kick out of watching as we unravel the intricate way he crafted things. The flip side is that he is sometimes amused when we get stumped for a while. I imagine him chuckling as my students and I, while thinking our experiments have finally made it possible to understand the quantum mechanics of our electron system, blunder upon yet one more clever twist that he built into reality. A third implication of this picture that's in front of you, this image of how God holds the universe. I call it the no fear principle. It's not one that many Christians Christians in many parts of the country have absorbed yet, I think. God breathes and sustains the universe. I think we accept that. We also accept that God provided the Bible glasses. Most Christians accept that. The challenge we have is in putting those two things together in the most obvious way. What he reveals in nature, if these things are true, cannot contradict what he says in the Bible. I'm going to say it again, because for decades in the United States, people, Christians, have been missing this point. Not you, I'm sure, but people in the Midwest. Okay? Oh, I take that back. This is going to be on video. I'm from the Midwest. I actually love the Midwest. It's I actually claim that you should be from the Midwest, because then you're well grounded and you can come to the coast without being ruined. But okay, let's get back to the no fear principle. God breathes and sustains the universe. God provides us the Bible. So what he reveals in nature cannot contradict what he reveals in the Bible. We shouldn't live our life in fear and hiding because some scientist is going to, you know, figure out something that contradicts our faith. Okay? Now, if there seems to be a disagreement, and there seems to be sometimes from time to time, or individual people may think there is, science can be misunderstood or can be misunderstanding the universe. Okay? And I can misunderstand or misapply the Bible. Both of those things are possible, but there can't be any contradiction at root. That's the no fear principle, and we should internalize it, I think. Now, in my view, the no fear principle is of great use when raising children. Some people have asked me about this. In my view, we should be on a number of grounds, yes. In my view, we should be quite ready to tell them that I don't know about a particular issue if we really don't, if we're puzzled about something that doesn't seem to be yet reconciled between the Bible and science. The fact that we believe the no fear principle, that there can be no contradiction, is a much more important thing to pass on to our children than wisdom about a particular issue at a particular time. Okay? Your kids are going to figure out that you don't understand a lot of things really quick, okay? And people who pretend otherwise are just in for a fall, okay? All right, fourth implication. A fourth implication of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is that the master of the universe could make the earth and universe however he pleased in whatever time period he desired. Now, I'm more forthright in talking about this. For years, I refused to talk about origins. I called it a heat and no light issue, meaning, even if you're wrong, you still get to go to heaven, right? Okay? But at some point I woke up and said, you know, we're embarrassing our God. We have to start talking about that. We should have used the no fear principle and talk about it. And for reasons I don't completely understand, this is much more obvious that God could create things as he wished outside of the United States than it is in the United States. Okay? He could have formed the universe in 6 days, as a not-so-careful reading of Genesis in an English translation might suggest, okay? He could have formed the universe in a very short Big Bang, followed by 15 billion years, which is the scientific explanation. He could have formed people in an instant. He could have sustained the evolution of life forms and species. God decides, we measure. We don't prescribe how God does it. We look, and we look without fear. This is our place in the universe. Now, to be more specific, I suppose that God could have done a six-day creation, as many folks that I know in other parts of the country I won't name. But if he did, he then had to be very sneaky and make it look like there's lots of evidence that it's much older. Okay? For example, when we look at stars, right, some of that light has been coming for millions of years. So if God made the Earth 6,000 years ago, he had to put all these light particles in there as if they've been coming for millions of years. You see how he had to do it? In the ground, he had to put just the right radioactive elements so that when I look at the ratios and say, oh, the Earth is 4 to 5 billion years old, okay, you know, God's laughing and he said, no, I just made it seem that way, okay, right? Now, I think that's intellectually defensible, but I don't like it, okay? It's intellectually defensible because I believe in a God that's so powerful that he could have done that, okay? But to me, it seems like cheating. It seems to contradict the other notion I have of God, is that he's very faithful. He's straightforward with me. He's not trying to fool me all the time. A fifth implication of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is that that we can seek solutions derived from science and understanding, and also pray. Okay? I hope you will indulge me if I conclude by illustrating this implication with a personal story. The story has a happy ending and no exploitation of difficult circumstances is intended. But some years ago, my teenage son was told that he, many years ago now, okay, he was told that he had no more than a 5% chance to survive his cancer. And it was cancer that CT and bone scans showed had spread through his whole body. Now, I reacted as any scientist parent would, seeking second and third opinions about the diagnosis and about treatment plans and grilling the medical doctors, poor folks, as only a scientist could. They had extra people on shift when it was time for my appointment by the end, okay? And as you know firsthand, it's really hard to watch someone you love undergo a rather barbaric therapy like chemotherapy and radiation treatment, still the best medical options for many types of cancer. I am delighted to report that my son did survive and that he is still free of cancer, now married and teaching science and consulting on science in a school system he went to as part of the Teach for America program. I'm very grateful to his doctors, and I'm very grateful to God, and I see no contradiction. Now, why tell this story? Many of you can tell your own stories just like this, okay? The reason is that in parallel with my relentless insistence upon the best medical solution, I repeatedly and deeply asked of God that my son would be cured. And if he wasn't to be cured, that he would get us through it. I asked that all the cancer cells would die, that the chemo and radiation damage to his body would be minimized, and I relied upon a deep and long-held faith in a God who is not only the master of the universe, but he cared about us. Now, I saw no contradiction or inconsistency in dealing with this awful situation as a person of science and a person of faith. A God worth having, it still seems to me, must be so unimaginably more clever and more powerful than we limited humans could ever understand, comprehend, that I could seek his help in prayer, even if my science did not comprehend or could not even detect how he would provide it. My time is almost ended, but it would be inappropriate to stop before admitting freely that there are many things I do not yet understand. There are many things that I do not yet understand about my science. There are many things that I do not yet understand about my Christianity. There are many things that I do not understand about how they fit together. For example, I do not understand how God could become human and live on earth. Okay, just don't get it. It's beyond me. I do not understand and even find it somewhat distasteful that Jesus would need to die so that I could live forever. I wouldn't have made it that way, but I'm not God. If I were God, I would have made people out of metal because they'd be more durable. So, you know, there's... Okay. Now, when in physics I do not understand something, this does not generally tempt me to abandon the framework and the methodology of physics. I am free to say I don't know and look on the unknown as a challenge and direct my physics efforts to maximize the likelihood that one day I will understand. Christians, and perhaps especially pastors in some places, should have the freedom and the responsibility of saying I don't know about matter, especially about matters that are not absolutely essential to their faith. I hate to say that, but Christians don't always afford them this possibility. You know, saying I don't know is sometimes taken as weak faith, okay, and strong statements are made. There's nothing quite as bad as Christians who think God is on their side when they're on the attack. Okay, we're capable of being pretty vicious. Now, I take the same approach of not understanding to matters of faith as to matters of science. Someday, I hope to understand. In fact, one important component of my notion of heaven, the new heavens and the new earth, as the Bible speaks about it, is a renewed place where we can much more readily obtain answers to these questions. I imagine the new earth to be a place we can pursue science with more clarity of purpose, clearer and deeper understanding, and without the distractions that we now suffer. There will be no grant proposals to write in heaven. In conclusion, I believe in a God who is beyond the reach of science. I believe in a God who is delighted when we scientists finally unravel another layer of our unbelievably intricate and wonderful reality. God is as important a part of my view of reality as is the physics that I love. I find that Christianity offers the most simple and most economical explanation of reality as I encounter it. Christian faith gives meaning. It enables and energizes my science. I have tried to, as honestly as I can, to expose my starting points, my religious roots to you. If you disagree, I hope that at least this lecture will prompt you to examine your own starting points. Apologetics is not only for others, it's also for ourselves, okay, when we doubt. The set of basic assumptions or metaphor which you believe by faith, without proof, and which you ascribed meaning with for your life is worthy of further scrutiny. Thanks.